Ek sê goeiemôre elke van julle in die huis van die Here op hierdie koue Saterdag. Ons is maar min mense hier, maar moenie worry nie. Dis baie engele wat saam met ons vandag hier is. Kom ons maak ons oetene op ons met gebed. Liewe Jesus, baie baie dankie vir die geseënde Saterdag so ver en baie dankie dat ons vandag hier kan wees en hoe u ons die week gelei het. Dat ons altyd dankbaar sal wees vir elke dag wat u vir ons sorg en dat u deel van ons lewens is. Vergewe ons lief alle sondes en gaan ons lief saam met elkeen wat hier teenwoordig is, dat ons 'n persoonlike geseënde boodskap van u af sal ontvang, soos u deur die diensknegte werk. Dis my gebed in die wonderlike naam. Amen. Daar was een verjaarsdag in die week, die tweede was Lynette Vermaak. Sy is nou nie vandag hier nie, maar sê vir haar baie geluk met haar verjaarsdag en mag die Here haar nog lank gespaar en dat sy ook altyd sal weet, die Jesus is elke dag saam met hulle. Daar is toch geen huweliksherdenkings nie, so oom Ben en ek en oom maar plan maak, dat ons nou ook maar hier kan opkom, nie. Okay, kom ons sing asseblief, of kom ons kyk die sending vir, kom ons sing asseblief lied 288 song, dankie. Goed, weer vir ons die versie op die laaste refrein versie, asseblief. Ek wil net weer die vele lees, maar hou het in die agterkop. En ons wandel daar en verstaan mekaar. En hy praat met my as sy kind. En die stil genoot daar die eer met God, sal iemand maar selde vind. Hou het in die agterkop. Okay, kom ons kyk ook na die siening vraag. Dankie, Greg.
The City of Eternal Spring is the perfect name for Medellin, Colombia. The residents here enjoy pleasant weather all year and are surrounded by mountains, colorful streets, and vibrant culture. Despite the beautiful surroundings, there are many needs here. The Columbia Adventist University, or UNAC, has found a way to minister to some of these needs. They discovered that surrounding communities lacked sufficient health care. With the help of students, the university created a mobile health clinic called the Social Innovation Mobile Laboratory, or LEMIS.
This wonderful project began in 2019, and we have been working on it for 4 years using the Social Innovation Mobile Laboratory that gives us the possibility of reaching communities and offering our services.
Henry is one of the many students helping with LEMIS. He is studying to be a paramedic and has taken a leadership role at the university.
I wanted to become a paramedic because I wanted to serve God and the ones around me with the knowledge I can get from the university to benefit their health. Here we provide the people principles about healthy lifestyle so they can really understand and learn how to take care of their own health through the simple things that God has led us and allowed us to have here on earth.
The LEMIS Health Project offers resources such as basic health checks, massages, and even a checkpoint for spiritual health and prayer. The volunteers are passionate about this project because they know they're following Christ's method of ministry.
I think that if Jesus was living today, he would be with us in this project because its purpose is to take others to better ways of living and a better life. And I think that's what Jesus wants for all of us. That's why he left his word. That's why he's always taking care not just our spiritual self, but also our physical.
This method of ministry to serve the physical and spiritual needs of the community is a key part of the Columbia Adventist University's education.
Jesus' life was centered on service, and that service is what we want to show today. It is one of our legacies as a university, as a mission, as a vision, that all our graduates do whatever they do with love, with dedication, and with humanity, and that they can serve others from different areas.
This education through service has made a big impact on Henry and the many other students who have seen the value of service.
I think it has inspired me by showing me how important my work can be to impact, to transform other lives so they can become free from sickness, illness, and that way they are going to be able to connect with their Savior.
Please pray for the LEMIS Mobile Clinic Project in Medellin as they continue to use Christ's method of ministry to serve their community.
Ek sê baie dankie Greg. Ek sal vir die jonger diakonis vra gou om die offer en danksienings op te neem asseblief. Dankie. Ons maak ons oor toe. Die Jesus, baie dankie dat u ons hierdie week gedra het, dat ons ook kon verdien en ook vir die wonderlike voorreg om te kan teruggee, Here. Ons vra asseblief dat u hierdie dank en offergawe sal seën en vermenigvuldig, sodat nog mense die waarheid kan ontdek en daai besluit kan maak om deel van die koninkryk te kan wees. Dis my gebed in die wonderlike naam. Amen. Een van die kortste versies in die Bybel is Johannes 11 vers 35. Jesus het geween. Het is net die drie woorde. In die Engelse Bybel is het net twee woorde. Jesus wept. En ek wil vandag een bietjie daarover praat. Of met julle boodskap deel oor crying. So in Engels, so verskoon my ma. Ek het so bietjie gaan kyk. Daar is 8 facts about crying. En die eerste een is conductive to health. Emotional tears contain stress hormones. Crying it out provides psychological relief and releases feel-good endorphin. So is eigenlijk goed om as een mens huil, om van die emoties ontslaat te raak. En dan hier so sê hulle, women cry more than men. Women cry 3 to 5 times more than men. En weer eens, dit is gezond vir hulle en is goed vir hulle. En dan partykeer as jy huil, dan kom het by jou neus ook uit. It flows from your eyes and through your nasal passage to your nose. Ok, hier sal sê, there's 4 types of tears, maar eindig is dan nie 3, want die 4 die ene is nog nie eindig bewys nie. Die eerste is emotional tears, overwhelmed by emotions. Die tweede ene is reflex tears, so as jy bijvoorbeeld, as jy een eiskel, die onion, of stuifmeel, wat in jou oor kom, om jou oor te, om het skoon te maak. En dan basal tears, lubricate your eyes and clean them, so dit moet jou oor skoon te hou. En natuurlijk die laatste ene, hulle noem het crocodile tears, maar dit is nog nie rechte tears, dit is mense wat act, wat nou komstig huil. En dan die vijfde ene is crying at night. En dit het nogal met my baie, die afgelopen rekje baie met my gebeur. More likely to cry at night than at day due to lack of sleep and tiredness of a long day and make it difficult to control emotions. En dan daarby, as ons gaan kyk na die 16 ene is waar hulle sê van cutting onions. When onions are chopped, chemicals that were previously separated by cell membrane combines with each other and with air, resulting in the formation of an airborne chemical that irritates the eye. The trick is to cut the onion underwater. This will prevent the sulfuric compounds from reaching your eyes. Ok, die 7e ene, dit is meer vir mense wat getrouwd is, maar ek gaan daar praat nie. En die 8e ene is tears of joy. En dit is my interessant, hierdie ene ene. Nou, dit is nog nie bewys nie, maar miskien kan ons dit bietjie gaan toets. When you cry of overwhelming joy, the first tear will come from your right eye. En as jy sad is, kom het van jou linker oog af. So dit is net interessant, ons kan bietjie gaan toets. En wil ek met bietjie uit Desire of Ages, waar die Jesus Lazarus opgewek het. Wil ek net een bykie met julle deel, toe hy ook geheil het. Where have you laid them, he asked. They said unto him, Lord, come and see. Together they proceeded to the grave. It was a mournful scene. Lazarus had been much beloved, and his sisters wept for him with breaking hearts. While those who had been his friends mingled their tears with those of the bereaved sisters. In view of this human distress, and of the fact that the afflicted friends could mourn over the dead while the Savior of the world stood by, en hier kom my woorde, Jesus wept. Though he was the Son of God, yet he had taken human nature upon him, and he was moved by human sorrow. His tender, pitying heart is ever awakened to sympathy by suffering. En hierdie het vir my baie beteken. He weeps with those that weep, and rejoices with those that rejoice. But it was not only because of his human sympathy with Mary and Martha that Jesus wept. In his tears there was a sorrow as high above human sorrow as the heavens are higher than the earth. Christ did not weep for Lazarus. Ek het altyd gedink hy het, maar eintlik het hy nie. For he was about to call him from the grave. He wept because many of those now mourning for Lazarus would soon plan the death of him who was the resurrection and the life. But now unable were the unbelieving Jews rightly to interpret his tears. Some who could see nothing more than the outward circumstances of the scene before him as a cause for his grief said softly, Behold how he loved him. Others seeking to drop the seed of unbelief into the hearts of those present said derisively, Could not this man which opened the eyes of the blind have caused that even this man should not have died? If it were in Christ's power to save Lazarus, why then did he suffer him to die? With prophetic eye, Christ saw the enmity of the Pharisees and the Sadducees. He knew that they were premeditating his death. He knew that some of those now apparently so sympathetic would soon close against themselves the door of hope and the gates of the city of God. A scene was about to take place in his humiliation and crucifixion that would result in the destruction of Jerusalem, and at that time none would make lamentation for the dead. The retribution that was coming upon Jerusalem was plainly portrayed before him. He saw Jerusalem compassed by the Roman legions. He knew that many now weeping for Lazarus would die in the siege of the city, and in their death there would be no hope. En wat my hoop gegee het, is dat ek nie alleen is, die Here stap op pad saam met my, en dis die hoop wat ek het. It was not only because of the scene before him that Christ wept. The weight of the grief of ages was upon him. He saw the terrible effects of the transgression of God's law. He saw that in the history of the world, beginning with the death of Abel, the conflict between good and evil has been unceasing. Looking down the years to come, he saw the suffering and sorrow, tears and death that were to be the lot of men. His heart was pierced with the pain of the human family of all ages and in all lands. The woes of the sinful race were heavy upon his soul, and the foundation of his tears was broken up as he longed to relieve all their distress. Jesus, therefore, again groaning in himself, cometh to the grave. Lazarus had been laid in a cave, in a rock, and a massive stone had been placed before the entrance. Take you away the stone, Christ said, thinking that he only wished to look upon the dead. Martha objected, saying that the body had been buried for 4 days.
Ons gewees,
and corruption had already begun. This statement made before the raising of Lazarus left no room for Christ's enemies to say that a deception had been practiced. In the past, the Pharisees had circulated false statements regarding the most wonderful manifestations of the power of God. When Christ raised to life the daughter of Jairus, he had said, The damsel is not dead, but sleepeth. As she had been sick only a short time, and was raised immediately after death, the Pharisees declared that the child had not been dead, that Christ himself had said she was only asleep. They had tried to make it appear that Christ could not cure disease, that there was foul play about his miracles, but in this case none could deny that Lazarus was dead. When the Lord is about to do a work. Satan moves upon someone to object. Take you away the stone, Christ said. As far as possible, prepare the way for my work. But Martha's positive and ambitious nature asserted itself. She was unwilling that a decomposing body should be brought to view. The human heart is slow to understand Christ's word, and Martha's faith had not grasped the true meaning of his promise. Christ reproved Martha, but his words were spoken with utmost gentleness. Said I not unto thee, that if thou wouldest believe, that should see the glory of God? Why should you doubt in regard to my power? Why reason in opposition to my requirements? You have my word. If you will believe, you shall see the glory of God. Natural impossibilities cannot prevent the work of the Omnipotent One. Skepticism and unbelief are not humility. Implicit belief in Christ's word is true humility, true self-surrender. Take you away the stone. Christ could have commanded the stone to remove, and it would have obeyed his voice. He could have bidden the angels who were close by his side to do this. At his bidding, invisible hands would have removed the stone. But it was to be taken away by human hands. Thus Christ would show that humanity is to cooperate with divinity. What human power can do, divine power is not summoned to do. God does not dispense with man's aid. He strengthens him, cooperating with him as he urges the powers and capabilities given him. The command is obeyed. The stone is rolled away. Everything is done openly and deliberately. All are given a chance to see that no deception is practiced. There lies the body of Lazarus in its rocky grave, cold and silent in death. The cries of the mourners are hushed. Surprised and expectant, the company stand around the sepulchre, waiting to see what is to follow. Calmly Christ stands before the tomb. A sacred solemnity rests upon all present. Christ stepped closer to the sepulchre. Lifting his eyes to heaven, he says, Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. Not long before this, Christ's enemies had accused him of blasphemy, and he had taken up stones and had taken up stones to cast at him because he claimed to be the Son of God. They accused him of performing miracles by the power of Satan, but here Christ claimed God as his Father and with perfect confidence declared that he is the Son of God. In all that he did, Christ was cooperating with his Father. Ever he had been careful to make it evident that he did not work independently. It was by faith and prayer that he wrought his miracles. Christ desired all to know his relationship with his Father. Father, he said, I thank thee that thou hast heard me. And I knew that thou hear me always. But because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me. Here the disciples and the people were to be given the most convincing evidence in regards to the relationship between Christ and God. They were to be shown that Christ's claim was not a deception. And when he thus had spoken, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. His voice, clear and penetrating, pierces the ear of the dead, and he speaks. Divinity flashes through humanity in his face, which is lighted up by the glory of God. The people see the assurance of his power. Every eye is fastened on the entrance of the cave. Every ear is bent to catch the slightest sound. With intense and painful interest, all wait for the test of Christ's divinity. The evidence that is to substantiate his claim to be the Son of God, or to extinguish the hope forever. En dit is wat ons moet vashou, dat ons weet dat die Jesus die Seun van God is, anders het ons geen hoop meer nie. There is a stir in the silent tomb, and he who was dead stands at the door of the sepulchre. His movements are impeded by the grave clothes in which he was laid away. And Christ says to the astonished spectators, loose him and let him go. Again, they are shown that the human worker is to cooperate with God. Humanity is to work for humanity. Lazarus is set free and stands before the company, not as one emaciated from disease and with feeble, tottering limbs, but as a man in the prime of life and in the vigor of noble manhood. His eyes beam with intelligence and with love for his Savior. The beholders are at first speechless with amazement. Then there follows an inexpressible scene of rejoicing and thanksgiving. The sisters receive their brother back to life as the gift of God, and with joyful tears, they brokenly express their thanks to the Savior. But while brothers, sisters, and friends are rejoicing in this reunion, Jesus withdraws from the scene. When they look for the life giver, he is not to be found. En dit laat my ook dink aan wat gaan gebeur as die Jesus gaan terugkom, en al die mense wat in die grafte is, gaan weer opstaan. En dit is wat my gehelp het, die moeilike tyd wat ek gegaan het. Ek wil eerstens vir julle allemaal sê baie dankie vir al julle gebede, vir julle ondersteuning. Ek sou het nie kom maak het as nie vir Jesus in julle was nie, so baie, baie dankie. Ek wil graag vir ons een kort videokie speel, en maar voor ons speel, die oukie praat van sy ma. Maar kom ons dink, elke keer sy van sy ma praat, kom ons dink aan liewe Jesus, wat ook die verhouding met ons wil hê. Dankie, Kriek.
My mom would be at all my sporting events. Let's say I was playing football, okay? My mother would be on the sidelines, and if the play on the field started going one way, my mother would run along like, Mike, get him, get him! I'd be like, I'd get in the huddle with the other guys, they go, Mark, is that your mother? I go, no, I never saw her before in my life. See, the greatest gift my mother ever gave me, she believed in me. I have overdosed on drugs on 3 occasions where I should have been dead. But I believe I was kept here for a reason. You show me your friends, I will show you your future. How do I know this? I hung out with losers, and I became the biggest loser of them all because I gave up everything I dreamt about as a little boy because of who I chose to surround myself with. My friends would drive me home at 2, 3, 4 in the morning. We'd be drunk and high, laughing in the car. We'd pull up in front of my house in New York. They go, Mark, Mark, the light's on. I go, oh man, my mother's up. See, my mom wouldn't go to bed until she knew her son was still alive. I'd walk in, she'd say, hi, Mark, how was your night? I go, good, Mom, I'm just gonna go to bed. She goes, can I talk to you for a minute? I go, Mom, I'm tired, I'm just gonna go to bed. She goes, Mark, I haven't seen you all day and all night. Can I please talk to you? I said, man, just leave me alone, you bug me. I'd slam my bedroom door on the one person who believed in me. I was on a worldwide tour and we were wrestling overseas in Japan. After my wrestling match, I went upstairs in my hotel room and I fell asleep. There was a knock at my door at 3 o'clock in the morning. I got out of bed and I looked through the safety window and I could see it was a Japanese promoter. So I opened the door and he said, Mark, you need to call home. There's been an emergency. I went and got on the hotel room phone. I called back to the United States and said, hey, what's going on? They said, Mark, I don't know how to tell you this. I said, just tell me what happened. All of a sudden they started crying. They go, Mark, I can't tell you. I said, just say it. He said, Mark, your mother died. I just threw the phone down. I ran out of my hotel room. I took the elevator to the lobby, and when the doors opened up, I just ran out into the street. I mean, there was no cars, there was no people. It's 3 o'clock in the morning. And I walked down the middle of a street in Hiroshima, Japan. And I remember looking up and just saying, Mom, I am so sorry. I flew home for her funeral, and I was so nervous to walk up to her casket, so I just stood way in the back. And I kept looking from a distance. I kept thinking to myself, Mom, please wake up. Please get up. And then I finally got the nerve to walk up to her. And as I got closer, I could see my mom for the first time. I mean, she was so beautiful. She was dressed in white. I mean, she looked like an angel. And I just stood over and I said, Mom, you are my hero. Everything I am, everything I hope to be was because of you. You loved me so much. You gave me a life. You're the only one that ever believed in me. How did I repay her? By getting drunk, by getting high, by getting stupid, by hanging out with losers? For what? All she ever wanted to do was talk to me. I wish I could talk to you now, Mom. I wish you could see what I'm doing. Why couldn't I have been a better son? We are defined by our choices. But if you surround yourself with people involved in drugs and alcohol and pills, it's a dead end. I'm not here to preach to you. I'm here to tell you I lived that life. It leads to broken hearts, broken relationships, broken dreams, and death. For what? To get high? If you have a mother or a father, when you go home, tell them how much you love them. See, my whole life was about being rich and famous. I had to be a millionaire. I had to win the race. I had to win the race to expense my marriage, my family, my friends. For what? To be all alone in the world? I learned what is truly important, and that is how precious this gift of life is and our families, and how quickly it can be taken away. See, I no longer live in time. I live in moments. See, it's not what's in your pocket that matters. It's what's in your heart that truly matters. Love. Love is just a word until somebody comes along and gives it meaning. You. You're the meaning.
Ah, jylle. Ek is so bly. Dat ek ook 'n vriend my ma gehad het. Jy het miskien ook nie 'n goeie vriend met sy ma gehad, die ma. Ons het nog 'n vrou, ek kies om 'n vriend met liewe Jesus te hê. En laat ons elk ding aan ons sal streef, jylle. En liewe Jesus sê vir ons, Openbaring 3:20, hy klop in ons hart, en hy wil hê, ons moet ons harte oopmaak, dat ons verhouding met hom moet hê, en die pad saam met ons stap. En ook, Openbaring 21:4, sê liewe Jesus, hy gaan eendag al die trane van ons oë afvee. En ek wil afsluit met 'n spesiale item, Greg Donkey.
I stumbled in
En geween sal daar nie meer wees nie. Amen, kom ons maak ons oor toe. Liewe Jesus, terwyl ons op die aarde is, gaan ons deur moeilike omstandighede, ons raak hartseer en ons is partykeer bekommerd. Maar ons weet, ons is nie alleen, die Here, soos U ook vir ons gesê het, as ons heil, heil U saam met ons, en as ons bly is, is U saam met ons bly. Leer ons asseblief om ons oë op U gerig te hou, en dat ons hoop kan, Here, soos mense kan weet, ons is lief vir U en dat U deel van ons lewens is, Here, en ons weet, een dag gaan U kom om almal wakker te maak, sodat ons vir ewig saam met U kan wees. En Here, leer ons asseblief om nie hopeloos te wees nie, maar elke dag die pad saam met U te stap, want ons kan net hoop by U kry. Dit is my gebed in die wonderlike naam. Dankie, Here, dat U ons deur die moeilike tye dra. Ons is baie, baie liefie en dankie dat U ook vir ons lief is. Dit is my gebed in die wonderlike naam. Amen. Baie dankie, jylle, ons gaan skuif vir die les 3.